money, bond, house, stock, and any other form of asset that you want to trade, you can trade in the asset market. Okay, in the simple formulation that we have done in the Keynes, okay, you have done in the macroeconomic fund, okay, wealth or asset, it is kept in two form. Okay, no need to make notes. I will tell you the page number. You can make your notes. Okay, just understand the concept. Okay, and write whatever you are understanding. Just write it out. Okay? No need to worry. Today I am not going to make you people write much. Okay, no need to worry because you have examined. So wealth or asset. Okay, in the Keynes formulation, is kept in the form of real balance, real cash balance, kept in the form of real cash balance and bond. Okay, this we also call money, kept in the form of money. And in the cash balance approach, you have seen that, okay, it is a formulation of Marshall Ellsworth. You have Keynes also associated with that name, okay, cash balance approach. Okay, so in the that cash balance approach, I talk about that, why this money is demanded. What is the reason that money is demanded apart from transaction purpose? Because money acts as a store of value, right? Agree? Yes or no? So it is a demand for real cash balance. Okay, so that is what we are talking. Money acts as a store of value. Okay, so that is a demand for real cash balance. Okay, that is your demand for money. Then we talk about bond. Okay, so assets or wealth is kept in two form. In the form of real cash balance. Okay, let me repeat one more time. Okay, otherwise two students that join, they will not be able to understand. Okay, so today we are going to talk about asset market. Okay, so asset market are the market in which money, bond, stock, houses, and any other form of stock, any other form of asset are traded. Okay, we are looking at simple version of Keynes. Okay, the wealth or asset is kept in the form of real cash balance, or you can say money and bond. Okay, real cash balance, because money has other role apart from transaction purpose. Okay, that is money act as a store of value. Okay, so that from there we have a real cash balance generating. Okay, so next look at a representative individual wealth constraint. Of any individual, we are taking a representative individual, okay, in the asset market. So this is point A, okay. So we are looking at a particular individual, that is our representative individual, his or her wealth constraint in the asset market. Okay, so asset can be kept in two form, real cash balance. Okay, so denote by N. Okay, this is real cash balance. Okay, then real demand for bond. Okay, we are taking everything in real term. Okay, so real demand for bond is a DB, demand for bond money. Okay, this is your real demand for bonds. Okay, and you have nominal financing wealth also. Okay, so this is the demand side. Okay, each individual have their demand. Okay, how much you want to keep in the form of cash. Okay, how much asset you want to keep in the form of cash balance, and how much you want to keep in the form of bond. Okay, so this is demand side. Okay, where the demand side coming from? He must be having some financing wealth. Okay, say that is nominal wealth or financing wealth, is W. Okay, this is nominal wealth and W. Nominal wealth and P is the price index. Okay, so this is in real term, this is nominal term. So when I divide this nominal wealth, okay, nominal financing wealth by price table, I will get real financing wealth. Okay, so this is the financing wealth of this representative individual. Okay, this must be equal to his demand in equilibrium. Okay, so let's write that thing. So real cash balance, so as demand for bond, okay, must be equal to your nominal wealth over price name. Okay, so this is the financing asset that this individual possessing. This must be equal to, okay, this financing asset that this individual have or you can say real financing asset because I have divided by the price number, must be equal to demand for both minus your demand for real cash balance. Okay? So this is what we have from individual side. Okay? Now let's look at the equation. So I just put it like this. Okay. One more thing. Okay. Let's look at this equation. Okay. At a particular point in time. Okay. Real wealth is given. Okay. At a particular point in time, real financial wealth is given. When I divide nominal wealth by price number, it is. I am saying real wealth. Sometime I am speaking real financial wealth. Okay. Both means the same thing. Okay. So given this, what will be the implication of the model? Okay. When your real cash balance is more, this term is more, okay? Demand for bond must be less so that this equality must be maintained. Okay? When demand for real cash balance increases, demand for bond must be decreasing. Okay? Given the position of your real cash balance, given the position of your real wealth. Okay? So the implication of this is that we no need to look at the asset market. Okay? If we only look at the money market, okay, the demand and supply of real supply of money, okay, or supply of real cash balance, or supply of real balance better, okay, is determined, okay, where you have demand of real balance, supply of real balance, okay, where they are in equilibrium, automatically bond market will be in equilibrium, okay. This implication we can drive, okay. How we can drive it, okay. To drive this, that implication, let's look at the financial, or we can say, just for a minute, real financial wealth of the economy, okay. To understand this thing, net look at the real financing wealth of the economy. Point number two. Real financial wealth of the economy. So I'm repeating this line again, okay? What I'm saying there, given the real financing wealth, if your demand for real cash balance is more, then demand for bond will be less. The implication of this is that if we only look at the money market and we are able to find the equilibrium in the money market, automatically we will be having equilibrium in the bond market. If demand for, okay, let me develop that part. Otherwise, okay. Then you have stock of real balance, okay, which is denoted by M. Okay. This is nominal stock of real balance divided by price number. Okay. This is nominal stock of real balance. Okay. And this is price number. You can say real money supply. Okay. In simple word, this is real money supply. This is stock of money. This is divided by price number. This is your real money supply. Okay. Okay. Plus supply of bond. Okay. Must be equal to the real financing wealth, okay? Nominal wealth over price number, okay? So whatever be the real financing wealth in the economy, okay? This must be equal to the supply of bond plus your stock of real balance, okay? So this condition must be holding, okay? So let's put these two things into equality, these two questions. So here this thing, same as this thing, right? So let's put that in equality. So demand for real cash balance and real demand for bond must be equal to this is real stock of cash balance, okay? Or real money supply, you can say. This is real supply of bond, okay? So let me put this equation. This is, you can say, real demand for money. This is real supply of money, okay, in easy word. This is real demand for cash balance, okay. This is real supply of money plus real demand for bond minus real supply of bond. This must be equal to zero, okay. Now, this equality must be holding, okay. If there is a equilibrium in the money market, okay, that means real money demand okay, for speculative purpose or money demand as a store, because money has one room or one storage value. Okay, this real money's demand, okay, is equal to real money supply. This term will be zero, yes or no? When money demand, real money demand equal to real money supply, this term will be zero. Yes. Yes. No. When money demand, or you can say real cash balance, okay, equal to your real money supply, this term will be zero. What happen? Okay. When this term will be zero, what about this term? This term must be equal to zero. Okay, then bond market will be automatically in equilibrium. Okay, demand for bond will be equal to supply of bond. Okay, so we no need to look at the entire asset market. Once we know that money market is in equilibrium, then the bond market will automatically will be in equilibrium. Okay, let's look at other possibility. Okay, okay, let's keep this one. This is first possibility. If this demand for real cash balance is more than supply of real cash balance, okay, then what will happen here? What should be the case? If this term is greater than this term, what will be the case? Demand of bond must be less than supply of bond. When you demand one asset more than the other asset, the demand for real cash balance is more than the stock of real balance in the economy, right? Right? Given your wealth, when you have more demand for this one, then you will have less demand for bond, other asset. Demand for bond must be less than supply of bond, then this equality will hold. Is it clear? This one? Yes, no? Okay. Similarly, the other way down, okay? If this is less than, that one is better. So net look at this situation from bond market perspective, because you have done from money market perspective, and I have done in the notes also that it is a demand for money and supply of money, okay, that determine the equilibrium rate of interest. Okay, this is real money supply, okay, you can say that. When I am saying this to be real cash balance, okay, you can say real demand for money, okay, for speculative purpose, that just keep that thing in the mind. When I am saying this is stock of real balance, okay, this is stock of money supply, okay, in real term. This is nominal money supply or nominal stock of real balance, okay. In the I am telling in the Don Bosco combination, otherwise you will be confused, okay. So you can just say this is real money supply, okay. I am divided by price number is your real money supply, okay. You can keep that formula. I am using the same formulation that they are talking, okay. So that you people when did not get confused. Okay. So we have seen that in the asset market, okay, if money market is in equilibrium, asset market will automatically be in equilibrium. And asset market here consists of your real cash balance as well as bond. That means your asset, your wealth is consist of real cash balance as well as bond. Okay. Next, look at one example that I have given previously to understand why there is an inverse relationship between rate of interest and price of bond. Okay, so let me write that thing on the thing again. Okay, one more time. This thing you should write it. Okay, this thing is important. Okay. Suppose face value of bond is 1000. Okay, and this is your bond. 1000 is the face value, and they say that 5% rate of interest you could get every year. Okay, by having this bond. Okay. This is the starting point that we have bond at the rate of 5%. Okay. This is guaranteed. I am going to get 5%. Okay. Now look at some period. This bond is issued in say 2015, 2016. I want to know, look at what will be the bond price in 2016. Same bond, 2017, 2018, and 2019. Okay. Then here is the market value. This is market value, this is face value, okay? I am talking about market value, how much you have to pay in the market to get this bond, no matter whatever written here, how much you have to pay, okay? and you will get interest payment for sure 50. No matter whatever be the market value, okay, you are going to get 50. So even at 1000 rupees face value, you are getting 50, not 500, 50. Whatever be the market value, you are getting 50 for sure. This is the only amount you will get by having this bond, no matter at what price you buy it, okay? If you buy in 2015, you pay 1000 rupees, you get 50 rupees, okay? Then the effective yield or rate of interest, effective yield, or you can write rate of interest, here is how much? 50 divided by 1000 into 100, it will be 5%, right? Suppose in 2016, okay? People start to demand more bond, okay? Then the bond price increases to 200. Now what will be the effective rate of interest? Face value is 1000, okay? But you are paying how much? 200 to buy that bond, okay? This bond. I am paying 200 rupees, but how much I am getting every year rate of interest? Only 5%, okay? Of the face value, not of this one, okay? I am getting 5% of the face value, that is 50. So even I am paying 200, I am getting only 50 rupees, okay? So 50 rupees is a 5% of 1000. Then 50 rupees is how much percent of 200? Check. It will be 4.16, something like this. 4.1%, right? Anyone check it, this one? Yes, no. Is it clear? 50 divided by 200 into 100, you will get effective yield 4.1%. That means in 2016, if somebody buy this bond that has face value of 100, he is getting only 50, but he has paid 200. Then the effective rate of interest is 4.1%. Okay. Suppose in 2017, bond price increases to 1600. Okay. You are paying 1600 rupees. Okay. But the face value is how much? 1000, okay, and the rate of interest is 5%, okay, on the face value you are getting only 50 rupees, okay, but actually you have paid 1600. So what will be your earning out of this 1600? Only 50 rupees. So 50 divided by 1600 into 100, you will get around 3.1%, okay. So what happens is that when bond demand increases, bond price increases very high. Next period what we see is that there is a decline in the bond price, okay, there is a supply, too much supply, so bond price declined and it is 800 now. It is written that this bond will give 5% of the face value, okay, no matter whatever is the market price. So this bond is giving me 50 rupees, okay, but at what price I buy this bond? Only 800 rupees, okay. Then how much is the 50 of 800? It is 6.2%. 6.5, okay, very good. 6.5%, okay. Suppose there is an oversupply of bond, bond price again reduces to 600, okay. Even market value is 600, but on the face value it is 1000, right? And in this 1000, you are getting how much? 5%, okay. You buy for 600, okay, but you will get 50 rupees. Why? Because the face value is 1000. Then how much will be the term? 50 divided by 600 into 100, how much it is? 8.3%, right? Yes or no? 8.3%. Yes, no? This is the case, right? What is the case here we have? When rate of interest is falling, what we have? Bond value is increasing, bond price is increasing, right? When bond price increases, look at this situation. Okay, when price of bond increases or market value of bond increases, okay, what is happening to rate of interest or effective rate of interest? It is falling, right? Yes or no? Rate of interest is falling from 4.1% to 3.1%, okay? That means demand of bond is more than supply of bond here, okay? Demand of bond is greater than supply of bond. You have to make this, okay? You will not find it. Next, what happened in 2018-19, okay? Here, bond price is decreasing. Look at the face value. Bond price decreases, right? Price of bond decreases. What will happen? Rate of interest increases. See, effective rate of interest. Effective rate of interest increases. Why? Because supply of bond is more than demand of bond. Okay? Supply of bond is more than demand of bond. Okay? Now, if we have demand of bond more than supply of bond, what will be the case? Just look at this equation that I have written here. That one. Just 1 minute. This is the case that I have written. This is real demand for money or real demand for cash balance minus real supply of cash balance. Okay. Minus demand for bond minus supply of bond equal to zero. Look at this case. When demand of bond is greater than supply of bond, demand of bond is greater than supply of bond, what will be the case here? Stock of real balance must be greater than demand for real balance, right? Yes or no? Okay. So in this way you can analyze, okay, when the price of bond increases, okay, when the price of bond increases, just remember they have a face value. You are paying more than face value. Suppose you are paying 200, face value 1000. Okay, then your effective rate of interest fall. Okay, your effective rate of interest fall. Okay, look at here. Rate of interest is 3.1%, right? Here rate of interest is 3.1%, and you are paying 1600. This is the price of bond. Okay, is it clear? Everything. Up until now, is it clear what I have said? Yes, no. Okay, one more thing I'm adding. Okay, this point you have written on it. When the rate of interest is high, okay, people will expect rate of interest to fall. Okay, this is the phase value, this is the actual rate of interest that you are getting, 50. Okay, when rate of interest is high, people will expect rate of interest to fall. Now what they will do? They will buy more bond, right? When rate of interest is high, people will expect rate of interest to fall. Yes or no? Why rate of interest is high? Because price of bond is low. Okay? So people will demand more bond. Ultimately, equality will be reached. Okay? Where supply of bond will be equal to demand for bond, then you will have equilibrium here also in the money market, okay? You get equilibrium here, when demand for bond increases, you get equilibrium, then you will reach equilibrium here. Is it clear? This statement we have written many times. I repeat one more time. When the rate of interest is very high, okay, people will expect rate of interest to fall, okay? People will expect rate of interest to fall. As a reason, demand for bond increases. When demand for bond increases, this equality will be achieved. Then you will have equilibrium in the money market also. Through bond market, I have shown you that we can achieve equilibrium in the money market also. And in the previous lecture, I have shown that how we achieve equilibrium in the money market. Okay. So I will be ending this section here. In the next section, I am going to introduce rate of interest determination in the classical model. Okay, just wait for me.